All right. So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sanjo and I'm from Aarti Farms Private Limited. It's a small vegetable processing company based in Odisha. We primarily do processing sweet potatoes and among other things. So that makes me very excited about what is to follow. Our first speaker for the day is Mr. Nilesh Lele, who's the founder and MD of Exelon Food Bio Advisors Private Limited. And the second speaker will be Ms. Subhaprada Nishtala, who is the director in charge at IDFSAN. We'll begin this discussion with a brief introduction to our first speaker, followed by his talk, and then we'll move on to the second speaker. Towards the end, there'll be a Q&A session where all of you can ask questions. Let's say our first speaker is Mr. Nilesh Lele. He's the founder and MD of Exelon Food Bio Advisors Private Limited. It's a food company. It's a company that provides technical and management consultancy to startups and SMEs across the food industry sector. Mr. Lele is also the director of Savarde Valley Food Foundation. It's an NGO that works directly with farmers across Maharashtra and has recently launched its Farm to Fork concept where they sell fresh produce. Besides that, he's also the proprietor of Exelon Basket, which is into carbonated and non-carbonated beverages, fruity beverages, which is into the manufacturing of exotic food wines. He's also presently the president of the Mumbai chapter of the Association of Food Science Technologies. Lastly, Mr. Lele also had NL Advisors, which is an investment banking advisory. They work with startups across India to scale their operations to various modes of fundraising. So, Mr. Lele, you can take it forward.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, Hello? You are.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. And thanks, Sanjog and the Kalinga Institute, TBI, the Incubation Center, for giving me an opportunity. So I guess I haven't been given 20 minutes. So I'll just, since we're already running late, I'll jump into my presentation. So if we can have my presentation on.
Yes, just a moment.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Next. So since this session has been organized by the Incubation Center, I'm assuming that most of these attendees are from various startups or wannabe startups. So, and always, obviously, investors are always on our mind. So I'm going to talk with regards to how investors look at it, and I will tie in the story. Don't worry. So a particular investor, when he's looking to invest in a particular startup, there are four or five basic points that we or investors in general look at. One is there a well-defined problem and whether the startup or the business is going to provide a particular solution. So Ola Uber being a classic example, the cab services was nothing new when Ola Uber jumped in, but probably there was a gap, there was a need wherein you could sit at home, order an Ola or an Uber at the fingertips, order it, book it anytime you want. They would never say no. Otherwise, typically in a place like Mumbai, you are at the mercy of the taxi driver, whether he'll come, he'll say yes, he'll say no, how much is he going to charge? So it was a pretty well-defined problem. So whether your startup or your idea or your business has a well-defined problem and whether you're going to provide a particular solution. Secondly, are you an industry mover or are you a first mover, industry leader? Is there any innovation? Is there any intellectual property? What that means is, you are doing something different and not just a me too kind of a product. Even though it's you are a first mover, there will always be copycats. So can you maintain your competitive advantage? So next point is whether the model is scalable. And that's why you'll see most of the tech-driven companies get funded very easily. In fact, today's newspaper, there is a agri-logistic company which has got funding where they're talking about data science and data engineering and a lot of tech is involved. So most of the investors, they like a scalable model. Next is, will the startup or the business model make money? Many startups forget that they are in a business primarily to make money, primarily to make profits. So if that is never going to happen, probably it's a wrong startup or a wrong idea or a wrong business that you're in. And obviously, as an investor, whether this startup will make money for me, whether they'll grow the business and also make money. So why do these above points matter? Next slide, please. The reason being that you as an entrepreneur are the first investor in your business. You're going to invest in time, money, efforts. So if you're not answering yes to the points that I mentioned in my previous slide, probably you're in a business where an investor is not going to invest. So obviously you as an entrepreneur or a founder or a starter should not be doing that business. So always remember, your time, money, efforts are going to be invested. So make sure the model satisfy most of the points that we saw on the previous slide. Next slide. So these are some of the points I personally have learned from COVID, and I've also seen others quote about it. So there are many startups I come across, or many ideas I come across, which are nice to have, a solar based something. But is it a must have? You have to make sure the product that you're making is in the must have category rather than just the nice to have category, which also ties into the next point, which is you should be part of a global value chain, which is difficult to replace. So even though we have a complete lockdown, essential commodities was not locked out. So your product should be part of an essential commodity kind of a, it should be a business where you're providing some kind of an essential commodity. Also, your supply chain should be resilient. No matter what happens, your backward and your forward linkages should be in place. Digital is the future. Already, many of us are talking about cashless transactions, digital marketing. Even like today, Zoom. How many of us really knew Zoom prior to the COVID? But today, almost all of us are on Zoom, GoToMeeting, GoToWebinar. So there are so many aspects of digital that will be part and parcel of our life. You also need to reassess and question your existence and the entire business model every year. In fact, you might be in a business which has already gotten outdated probably in a previous quarter. So that's another thing I've learned during this COVID crisis. We also need to rethink every cost that we incur. I see a lot of startups just splurge on a lot of marketing, ATL, BTL activities, and also a good time where, you know, we have so much time at hand to rethink about our business future and also about our life future. So I know that I'm sounding a little philosophical, but I'm just trying to lay a ground where I want to get into the meat of my presentation. So these are some of the points I've learned primarily from the COVID lockdown. Now, next please. So I have quoted some essential products or essential commodities that are grown in India. If you notice, India is in top three producer of almost everything. If we are not number one, probably China is number one, we are number two. So including the land available, wheat, rice, paddy, milk. In fact, India is the largest producer of milk, but still we are deficient on milk. In fact, I'll give you an example of milk, and it will also talk about what I think many startups should do. Is milk is available at around 50 rupees a liter today. But yesterday I bought Amul Dahi, and the 400 gram of Amul Dahi costed 65 rupees for that pack. So I was wondering, so it's almost coming out to almost 150 rupees a kg. So the same milk which is being sold at 50 rupees a liter effectively is getting sold at 150 rupees a kg. So that's the value addition. So one of my slides talks about it. So what kind of a startup you should have is a startup which is not in a particular me-too or a commodity kind of a thing, but more into a value addition. So dairy value added products is a big, big industry. And you see most of the private dairies playing a huge, you know, having a big range of dairy products. So you'll notice we are largest producer of fruits, vegetables, oil seeds, you name it. And India is a large producer. Why it is important? Especially because you want to go into a trading or in a manufacturing kind of a setup. Knowing your raw material availability, because it's also seasonal and regional, is very important. So knowing your backward linkages is very crucial deciding what kind of opportunity you want to tap into. Next, please. There are a few other points I've put in, and I'm willing to share my presentation. You can take photos, whatever. So there are so many things that are conducive in India. We have almost the largest arable land. We have all the 9 agro-climatic zones. So in effect, we can grow anything that is grown anywhere in the world in India. We have round the year sunshine. We can cultivate a lot of different range of agriculture products. You know, we have a vast pool of skilled manpower. We have a huge population, huge middle class population. 130 crore people eating 3 meals a day translates into almost 400 crore or 4 billion meals every day. Last line is also very important. We are basically adding 1.5 crore people every day. What that translates into, our population is adding one Australia every 2 years. Australia has hardly 2.5 crore population. So in effect, we are adding an Australia every 2 years. So there's a huge demand or a huge potential over here. One definite point I would like to add here is India has a surplus of production in all the things that we saw on the previous slide, right? And that is probably the reason why we have not taken post-harvest losses or our supply chain or our cold chain that seriously, because we have always had excess production. The challenge is with the distribution, but to feed 130 crore, definitely India produced more than what 130 crore can consume. So which can also be a point as to whereas the world is hungry. So India has excess and world is hungry. So that can be another opportunity where, you know, the large amount of exports are, there's an opportunity in export, especially in Middle East, where hardly any fruit vegetables are grown. And India has a big potential of exporting such produce there. The major point to note, if you're going to do, going to focus on export, is the world is asking for traceability. So have a business model which will work on the traceability of your produce, especially if you're looking to export. Next, please. One of the points I always tell many startups is, and I know there's one question that came in saying, will canned food industry look a growth? I would always advise that you need to look at the market first and come backwards rather than product and go forward. So first observe in the market whether canned food is getting consumed, who are consuming it, which markets, which products are getting consumed in the canned form, and then come backwards rather than making a product and then going to the market. Obviously, canned products are big hit, especially in the Western world. Like I can tell you, a product like gherkin, I don't know if you're aware, but cucumbers and gherkin are one of the largest agri exports happening to Russia and Europe. In fact, India has a 16% market share of the global export that is happening in a single product like gherkin. It's going in a typical glass jar. So again, come market backwards rather than going product forward when deciding what products to do. Obviously, your startup or your business ideas can be around reducing post-harvest losses, which stand at around 30 to 40% of what is being produced. You can look at a lot of supply chain efficiencies, right from first mile delivery to last mile delivery. You know, we're looking at the likes of Swiggy's and Zomato's, who have now been given approval to even deliver alcoholic beverages. So there is a lot of scope in having your startup venture into supply chain utilities, supply chain efficiencies. Obviously, there are a lot of unutilized food. Few other examples I'll give you is millets is becoming a big thing. We used to call them bajra, jwari, nasmi. Now it has been given a glamorous name and rebranded as millets. So those are going to see a lot of scope in the near future. Protein. Especially plant protein is going to be a very big thing in near future, as especially the Western world tries to move towards move away from non-vegetarian sources of protein. So those could be some of the business ideas. Food processing waste, for example, and I have it on one of the slides, where a huge amount of mango is processed, but the skins and the stones are thrown away. We all know it's edible. Cows eat it, so there's nothing wrong. So they are obviously edible, and they in fact have a lot of nutraceutical bioactives in it, which can be extracted and marketed, if marketed properly, can generate a lot of value. So the theme is valorization. Valorization in simple layman words is value addition. So what you can do is you can always, any waste that you have, you try to make a human food out of it if possible. If not, then make an animal feed. If not, then make a compost or a biogas. And if not, then you use it for direct burning. Unfortunately, whatever can be used as human feed is being used as animal feed. What can be used as animal feed is actually going for burning. So there is a lot of scope where I call it a wealth from waste, which can be generated from even from food processing waste. Okay, next, please. I'm going to quickly go through the slide. You'll see that a lot of Western world, even the countries like Malaysia, Thailand, are processing more than 30% of their produce, where India stands at 8%. Obviously, there are reasons, but I believe that this percentage will keep going higher and higher as our society moves towards more ready to eat, ready to cook kind of options. Next, please. So these are some of the global trends that we are seeing. Clean label, like no added flavors, no added preservatives, no added sugar kind of thing. So clean labels is something we are seeing in the Western world. Wholesome nutrition. So, you know, you have the five fingers, the three macronutrients and two vitamins and minerals. So all five available in a particular food. So wholesome nutrition is now becoming a very big thing. Certifications and regulations. People are asking for organic. People are asking for various certified products in the market. Next, please. So what are some of the trends that we are seeing in India? Because the global trends have not necessarily seen in India. They may come in the next 3 to 5 years. So what's actually happening in India? We are seeing a lot of demand for safe food, a lot of demand for convenience food. So like cut vegetables, frozen peas is a big hit. Obviously, health and wellness are going to be a big thing. You know, people now are aware that you have to boost your immunity. You have to take maybe health supplements, take some nutraceuticals. So a lot of this health, wellness, functional food, nutraceutical, these are going to see a lot of scope and a lot of growth in near future. A lot of organic, vegan, even traditional food is going to, like I had said in one of my messages, that the masala dabba that we have at home is full of antioxidants, is full of things that can boost your immunity. So people are going to move back and look at a lot of traditional recipes. Obviously, ready to eat, ready to cook, on the go, you know, frozen. These are some of the trends that are already in India, and we'll see larger growth, not just because of COVID, but in general because of the changing consumer patterns. Next. There's a huge scope, like I mentioned, a value addition should be the key. Nutraceutical, you know, where you're looking at health-based, organic. So I've covered a lot of these topics, even prebiotic, probiotic. If you look at the, some of the dairy products that are out there, which are being promoted as a prebiotic, especially to maintain our gut, we'll see a lot of growth. So you need to observe what is happening in the market to understand what the buying patterns are and where we are going as a trend, as a country. Next, please. I'll just leave you with few of my pet topics, and probably this is my last slide. Mango peels and seeds, I told you. Obviously, we all know shea butter, we know cocoa butter. Similarly, mango has mango butter. It can be a very a substitute for shea butter or cocoa butter. Obviously, peels has a lot of nutritional values. In fact, there are people who have done research on it where it has like isabgol kind of properties, especially if given to cattle. Then rice bran. In fact, we all know that the brown rice costs 100 rupees, whereas a polished rice costs 50 rupees. So basically, you're giving 50 rupees extra for the bran. But when it is polished and when the rice bran is available, that gets sold as cattle feed for 15 rupees. So the valuable thing is actually getting sold for a lesser value just because it's separated out. So in fact, I've seen some startups make some rice bran biscuits. Obviously, rice bran oil is a well-developed product in the market, but there's rice bran wax also available. Similarly, India is one of the largest or the largest producer of sugar cane. There's a lot of cane wax available, which is on the coating of the sugar cane, which is edible. So, you know, the carnauba wax or any of these edible waxes that India imports, we can obviously have some substitute for it. Jackfruit, as we all know, is in fact a superfood, provides all the macro and micronutrients. Unfortunately, more than 80% of jackfruit goes waste. It also has this latex, which can, some startups can have a altogether a different idea and can use it. That latex can be mixed with, or the jackfruit can be mixed with the concrete to actually increase the tensile strengths of the strengths of the concrete and give you better results and probably less potholes on the roads. Cashew apple, as we all know, more than 22 lakh metric tons goes waste just in the two districts of Maharashtra. It has 5 times more vitamin C compared to an orange or any other citrus fruit. So a very high source of vitamin C. Hardly 100 ml of cashew apple juice can give you 1 RDA of vitamin C. Similarly, D-oil cakes, once groundnut oil is extracted mechanically, and what you have is what we call pained in Marathi. Unfortunately, it goes as animal feed, whereas it can actually be used as a high protein, low fat kind of ingredient to make your bars or stuff like that. Yeah. So yeah, I'm done. I think next slide has some of my coordinates on it. And, next please. And I'm done. So over to you, Sanjog, and obviously Shubha. And I'm open to take questions at the end.
Thank you, Rilesh. I think there were some questions that we have already received in advance, which I think you've already covered some of those questions we were talking. But we'll keep the questions for the end, and we'll go on to the next speaker. So let me introduce you to you, our next speaker.
Hi, Sanjog.
So, Ms. Subhabrata Nishala is the director in charge at ITSN, which is the International Training Center for Food and Safety on food and safety, food safety and nutrition. It's a training center that has been jointly set up by FSSAI and the Export Inspection Council. And Ms. Nishala is a senior food professional, food safety professional with over 20 years of experience working with companies such as Coca-Cola and Alcabir Exports. She has a range of experiences from handling audit, training delivery, frontline factory operations, quality assurance, among other things. She's also an alumni of CFP RI Mysore, and she's presently the vice president of the Association of Food Science Economists of the Mumbai chapter. She's worked with, right now, she will be talking about certification and licensing and compliances that are required to be more appealing. That's what I understood when I spoke with her, but I'll let her take this forward and over to you.
Thank you, Sanjog. I'll just start my screen share before I. Yes. I think somebody else is sharing the screen. There is a gentleman, Prabhat Yadav, who is sharing the screen. Sir, if you could stop your screen share, please. Mr. Prabhat Yadav? Yes, thank you. So, thank you, Sanjog, for that introduction, which was slightly longer than what I had shared. But I appreciate the detailed introduction. I'll skip my introduction slide. After Nilesh has given essentially a power capsule of what opportunity exists and the manner in which to address it for startups, both in terms of consumer building approach and an investor attracting approach, I will be focusing on certifications and regulations, essentially the trust story. How do you build the trust for your stakeholders? We'll speak about regulations. We'll look at different types of certifications that are available. We'll talk briefly about food safety, a very, very short segment relevant to COVID-19 aspects, and then take question and answers. Now, before I go further, I would like to differentiate between regulation and certification. Regulation by definition is something which is mandatory, which is required for compliance as per the law of the land. For us, the primary regulatory body, and I emphasize the primary regulatory body, there are others, is the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, which governs all things that are required around regulating both the standards, which is the quality of food products, as well as the safety of food products. Certifications by nature are voluntary. They, however, may become mandatory because a customer mandates it or a regulator mandates it. For example, your customer could tell you that I need a GMO certification. So it becomes mandatory to you as a business, but is not a generic mandate across the country. Similarly, certain certifications might be mandated by a regulator. For example, for packaged drinking water, FSSAI says you need to get a BIS certification. So that becomes a mandate through a regulator. But in essence, certifications are voluntary, regulations are mandatory for compliance. And if you do not meet a regulation, you are in effect not complying with the law of the land. Before we go into some degree of detail there, a little bit about trust. This graph that I have is from the Edelman Trust Barometer, which says that while we are seeing an increase in, and this is also an exercise that I do when I have the opportunity, when I had the opportunity long ago to meet people face to face and do a training, I would ask them, how do they rank their confidence in food products in their own businesses or generally food business as a consumer? Do they give it a green ranking where they feel complete trust, an orange ranking where they feel we are almost there but something is missing, or a red ranking where, you know, they say, hey, there's too much to worry? Most people, around 64 to 65% of the people, fall in the orange zone. And that's what even international data tells us, that the trust that is there in food businesses, while it has improved over the last 5 years, it is not improving at the same rate that trust is improving in other businesses. Now, there are a few areas which are specifically not keeping pace or dragging down the overall percentage. Agri businesses, fast food. These are perceived as consumers as something which are not very trustworthy. Questions that largely come from consumers are about values and integrity. They do not so much mistrust the food itself. What they mistrust is the food manufacturer's values and their integrity. And surprisingly, when a similar survey is done for the employees of food and beverage manufacturing firms, we see similar results. So the concerns are similar for an employee of a firm as well as a consumer. How then do we address building trust? I'm audible, right? Sanjog, I'm audible?
Yes, you're audible. Yeah, Shubha.
Thank you. So how then do we continue? How then do we work on building trust? The top three aspects that we need to work on is emphasis on ethical sourcing and chain of custody. Nilesh spoke about the importance of traceability in the global markets. As opportunities opened up, we had our Honorable Prime Minister yesterday talk about local, vocal, global, and I'm sure those of us who work in the food industry appreciate that we are a segment which is, to a certain degree, been immune to the sheer damages that other industries such as hospitality has seen. We do appreciate that there is a large window of opportunity opening up, but these three things are something that we need to build on to build that trust, not just for global consumers, but as much for the new consumers of today who look at things like ethical sourcing. People who are buying eggs are willing to pay that little bit more to know that the poultry was well treated. If they're buying meat, they would like to have a declaration that yes, the animal was treated right. Same goes for dairy. And they would like to know the chain of custody. What is the traceability? With an amazing degree of speed, we have enablers like blockchain coming into play, which help you just scan a barcode and see the entire detail of every ingredient in your food product. This is going to go a long way in building trust. The second thing that we need to look at is truth in advertising. Now, advertising and claims, and as somebody who's done a lot of work around building claims for brands, there's always a very fine line. Do you say unsweetened? Does it mean that it has apple juice in it, but you've not added sugar? Do you say organically sourced when only one ingredient is organically sourced. So this is what breaks trust. There needs to be truth in the advertising, relevant and representative of the product, authentic information and transparent information. So largely these are the three pillars on which we see trust being built up, and certifications or regulations help us work towards building these for our organization. So if you have a labeling regulation, if you have a claims regulation, it's helping you build pillar two. If you're talking about a certification on, let's say, on GMO sourcing or organic sourcing, it's helping you build on pillar one. Whatever certification you pick and choose, unfortunately, regulation you cannot pick and choose, those are mandatory. But whatever certification you pick and choose, you are trying to align them to one of these three so that it becomes a building block of trust to your consumers and helps you build your brand. Now, very quickly, going over the regulations part of it, I'm assuming that the FSS Act and regulations are something that everybody is aware of. The Act being the primary mandate which allowed FSSAI to be formed, and the regulations being the requirements for businesses that FSSAI subsequently brought out and continues to bring out over a period of time. Now, these are some of the benefits. How are we seeing FSSAI work? The online food licensing and registration system, which has helped us today, where physical hard copy submissions have become almost impossible. It continues to allow us to give licenses for food businesses. But I won't go into all of that. Again, my presentation will be available, and I'm happy to take any questions around these during Q&A. This is the enforcement structure. We have a chief executive officer, we have state, and we have central authorities. The central authorities are designated officers who work towards all the central license holders. State licensing are state authorities. They do not report into FSSAI. They are a parallel enforcement wing. The FSSAI is, so to say, the standards maker, the regulations maker, and they have a small enforcement division in their central license authority. But the larger enforcement in the country happens through the states. The state food safety commissioners or food and drug commissioners are report into their ministers of health, state ministers of health, and not into FSSAI. The registration authorities, which is for the registration category, is normally the municipalities or the local panchayats, again under the state authority. Now, very quickly, the thumb rule for registration versus licensing. So as per the Act, every food business needs to be licensed unless they are exempted. And the exempted category need to get registered. So you need to, what it means is that you need to justify why you are being a registered food vendor, food business, and not a licensed food business. Having said that, turnovers, mind you, turnovers and not profit or income, less than 12 makes you eligible for a registration category. There are certain other requirements in terms of capacities for milk and meat, which pushes you into licensing. But largely less than 12 lakhs to make you eligible for registration. Licensing, split between central and state licensing. We have a Schedule 1, which defines specifically which businesses must obtain a central license. For example, if you're a manufacturer of proprietary food, you need to go for a central license. If you are a manufacturer who's supplying to one of the central authorities, such as the defense, such as railways, such as seaports, then you need to go for central license. But other than that, anybody with a capacity greater than 2 metric tons per day or a turnover of 20 crores per annum falls into central licensing. There are certain differences. There's a detailed breakup in terms of different kinds of business, what warehousing capacities, chilled versus ambient. There are certain further classification to this, but more or less, this is where we stand for central licensing, and everybody else comes into a state licensing. Now, FSSAI has been working on building consumer confidence on three aspects. They're working on safe food, healthy food, and sustainable food. And the reason I'm picking this up now is, in addition to the FSS regulations, which are mandatory, FSSAI themselves have a range of voluntary certifications which are available for the food industry to explore, to get certified to. So you could be certified as organic food vendor by FSSAI, which is under the Jaivik Bharat scheme. If you are a restaurant, they have a hygiene rating system in place, which is voluntary, not mandatory. You can seek that audit to happen and you can have yourself certified by FSSAI or one of their partners, but essentially an FSSAI certificate as certain stars, a 4-star hygiene rated restaurant and such like. So there is the entire fortification scheme, which gives standards for 5 staples. It allows you to claim the double F logo and print the double F logo for milk, oil, rice, salt, and wheat flour. They have set in place standards. If you meet those standards of the degree of fortification or the concentration of fortification for various vitamins and iron, you are able to use the double F logo. So FSSAI themselves, in addition to the mandatory regulations, also has these initiatives that they have taken to build sustainability, to build health, and to build safety. Safety, of course, is non-negotiable. But to drive consumer confidence, they are lending their logos based on certain requirements. And this is something that we should all look at. FOSTAC, I'm sure, is something which everybody would be familiar with. There is that falls under a mandatory requirement for state and for all license holders, not for the registration category, but for all license holders, that you have 1 in 25 employees who is certified FOSTAC trained through FSSAI training partners. Right. Now, in addition to FSSAI, for certain commodities, we have other regulators who come into play. We have the Marine Products Export Development Authority, who establishes standards for export of marine products. We have APIDA, which works towards the agricultural processed foods. We have commodity boards like coffee board, rubber board, tea board, tobacco board, spices board. All of these have their additional requirements over FSS requirements which need to be implemented. Largely coffee, tea, and spices applicable for India as well. Marine, APIDA, and export EIC, these are for exports of products from India and not for products which are being sold within India. So EIC has certification for mandatory for export of fish and fish products, dairy products, honey, egg, meat and meat, poultry, and certain additives and pre-mixtures. Whereas they also have a range of certifications which are voluntary products. This helps you. Why? Because an EIC certification prior to shipment leaving the country is a very cost-effective manner of ensuring that your consignment meets with the customer country requirements. EIC has mutual acceptance agreements with various countries, with EU, with the Middle East, with Malaysia, with Indonesia, which accept the EIC certification for consignments that are going out of India. Now, coming to the voluntary certifications, essentially voluntary certifications can be of three types. You could certify the product. For example, you could pick up a bottle of packaged drinking water and say that this product is certified to a particular standard. Or you could certify a process, which is you are looking at the manufacturing process, you're looking at the business management process, you're looking at the entire value chain and certifying the process. Or increasingly there are now certifications which allow you to do a source or an origin certification. So this could be a GI tag, this could be organic. Some examples of certifications for product are the Bureau of Indian Standards. Again, these are all voluntary. If you are a startup and if you are developing a new food product, it would be of merit to go to the BIS website and check the standards that are available there. BIS has standards, as does Codex, of course, for almost every kind of food. So from biscuits to flour, to chips, to sausages, to a whole range of products in addition to what FSS mandates. BIS has additional quality standards which it has published, which are not mandatory. But as you are building your organization, I would recommend that you have a look at the BIS standard, because it helps you build a more robust quality system within the organization. AgMark, BIS certification is mandatory for certain food products like condensed milk and packaged drinking water, infant foods, etc. through the FSS notification. Otherwise, BIS is by itself not mandatory. AgMark, which is for mandated through FSS for blended oils and ghee. Fortification of products, again through FSSAI. Then you have the increasingly popular gluten-free, lactose-free. These are all product certifications. Kosher, halal, we see GEN certification, we see vegan food certification. So all of these are product certifications. The process certifications are what we know better as HACCP, Hazard Analysis and Critical Control Points, where the value chain is assessed to see that it is capable of delivering safe product. So most popular amongst these are ISO 22000, the British Retail Consortium, FSSC 22000. We have other certifications such as Social Accountability, SA 8000, which reviews things like, are the products being ethically sourced? Is child labor being used in the manufacturing or in the suppliers of the manufacturer? Are fair wages being paid? So a whole lot of these social accountability factors are, it is also possible to certify. Coming to the origin, organic certification, which is done by many private certification bodies, it is also done through APIDA. It is done through the participatory guarantee scheme. And all of this today is vetted by FSSAI with the Jaivik Bharat scheme. Non-GMO, which requires extensive testing to ensure that your products are not having traces of any GM material. Things like RSPO, which is for palm products, on sustainability of the palm oil. Similar scheme for sugar and sugar products is Bon Sucro. So a lot of these origin schemes, we have certifications which can do GI identification. So is the basmati originally from basmati, or is the santra from Nagpur and such like. Now, what do we look at all these certifications for? Should we be looking at more and more certifications? What kind of certifications should I, as a small industry, as somebody who's starting up, go and look towards? Now, there are, in our country, honestly, there are different levels of quality in the certification process itself. My advice is, please find a certification partner who does a robust job of assessing the standards and the requirements. It is now becoming fairly commonplace for consumers to take consumers and consumer groups to take organizations to court for mislabeling, for wrong information sharing, etc. And in fact, 2019, we have records that say that class action lawsuits against food and beverage manufacturers saw one of the highest increases over the last decade. consumers are looking for complete transparency. And for a business to build that trust, especially around the traditional and Indian foods, which we expect will see a resurgence due to a whole lot of reasons, some of them which were discussed by Nilesh, we need to find a partner who is working with us in all of these certifications to ensure that we're ensuring two things. A, the process is robust, and therefore, should there be a mistake, you bounce back. Error always happens. It is not wrong for a mistake to happen. We must build a system which allows us to identify that mistake very quickly and hit the ground running in terms of response to that mistake. Be that as big as requiring a recall of your product, be that as small as missing out a small hazard in your assessment. So the focus of why certification is very squarely to enhance your robustness as an organization in building better and stronger systems. The secondary benefit of that is improved consumer trust. But if you just take a certification for consumer trust without improving your systems, it's, I think, a fairly thankless and frustrating exercise. So the message really is we don't stay ignorant of the consumers are changing, things are changing. We don't stay watchful of what may happen and, hey, if my competitor does it, I will do it as well. If you want to finish first, you have to predict what is going to change and seek those kind of certifications which will give you the first mover advantage. And there are certifications. What I put here is probably just 2 to 5% of the available schemes there are. Within each of these, there are further subcategories and specialized certifications available. So understand what is your requirement within the voluntary scheme and then seek help as to which would be the best fit of certification. This would differ from your product type, to your consumer type, to your market type, and should be well thought out before picking up a particular standard for certification. All right. Now, next 2-3 minutes on COVID-19 and what we are seeing as safety. So often a question coming through is COVID-19 transmitted through food? As of now, no evidence of it being foodborne. Now, there is a difference between being a foodborne disease and food being a source of contamination. Yes, very much our food can have a surface contamination of the virus, and handling that food can lead to a contamination and infection. What is not as yet evidence, thankfully, is the food becoming a source of a foodborne pathogenesis or foodborne infection, which means by eating the food, you are not getting an infection of your digestive system, of your GI tract. It could still be a source of contamination for you to get the respiratory infection because of surface contamination. But eating poultry, eating seafood is not transmitting the disease. That is not as yet seen, and it seems to be unlikely. All right. Now, FSSAI has recently given out, I think 3 weeks ago, not so recent, given a guidance document on how food industry should respond to the current situation. They've given specific requirements of physical distancing, of cleaning and sanitation, and personal hygiene, which must be put in practice by different kinds of business. So they have specific suggestions and recommendations. This is not a mandatory document as of today. It's a guidance document for transporters, for retailers, for manufacturers, for restaurants and warehouses. So for these categories, these are in place. In addition to the Schedule 4 requirements, which are always a condition of license and mandatory. So essentially, they're talking about additional to what all that we already do in the food industry is a more stringent check on personal hygiene, thermal screening at entry, and a mandatory use of the Arogya Setu app. In fact, the Ministry of Home Affairs has said that every business head is responsible that their employees are using the Arogya Setu app. So that's a mandate in the current situation. In addition to this, 1 meter physical distancing, and the guidance talks about specific cleaning disinfectants and sanitizers which are effective against SARS-CoV-2. We need to understand and appreciate that the common disinfectants and sanitizers that we use in the food industry for an E. coli or for a salmonella may not necessarily work against the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And the guidance document lists some of these. There are other sources such as the US FDA, which has a far higher number of chemicals that can be used. All right. Now, the other question that should come to mind is, in this situation, how do I relook my food safety assessment? Current conditions, hazards. So when we talk about a food safety assessment, we are talking about essentially two kinds of problems or hazards or risk that we are facing. One is an intentional hazard being added to food because somebody wants to adulterate and economically derive a gain out of it. Second, where they are intentionally adding in things into the food chain because their motivation is to damage the brand value of whichever organization, or it could be an employee who's been sacked or who's been disciplined and they just want revenge, which is why they are damaging. So these two form the intentional hazards. The economic gain one is called fraud, and the ideologically motivated one is called threat. So we have threat assessment in critical control point, and we have vulnerability assessment in critical control point to address these. And we have the old faithful or hazards, which are unintentional or accidental inclusions into the food system, which could be biological, chemical, or physical hazards, which we control through HACCP or Hazard Analysis and Critical Control Points. Now, when we restart our businesses after the lockdown or we step up our manufacturing capacities, we must be cognizant and we must remember that the likelihood of all three of these happening stands today at a higher probability than it was 3 months ago. Therefore, every business must relook and reassess their system to see if there are additional hazards, threats, or vulnerabilities so that these can be addressed before our damage is done. So that is the end of my session. These are my coordinates at ITC EPSAN, and I think Sanjog, over to you.
Thank you so much. We do have a few questions that were given to us through the Google form that the participants had signed up in. I've tried to collate some of the questions the best in the rest of time. We try to push this. I know we are running late, but we try to push this for 10 more minutes. And those who are running late or have something else to do can leave. What I've done is these questions, I'm trying to choose some of the broader questions that will be relevant to most of us. So one of the questions is this a good time, in both your opinions, to start something new, a new product or even a new food processing unit? And connected to that is, what might be the priority sectors in the post-COVID-19 era in food processing? Some of the people who have posed this question, many of them have, are Asit Mohanty, who is the co-founder of Kushuko Service Private Limited, and Nirmal Mahapatra of Utopia, Sri Samarendra Sahu, who is advisor to PTBA, and Mr. Gyanam Samvardham and Haritha Kumar Dham.
I think Nilesh, you should go first with this.
Sorry, I couldn't hear. What's the question?
Sorry, Dilesh. I'll repeat it again. Is this a good time to start a new food processing venture or a new product line in the post-COVID era? And what might be the priority food processing sector if one has to do something new?
See, I'm an optimistic guy, so I would say there is it's always the right time, COVID or no COVID. So definitely it's the right time. The criteria should be what I had presented in my presentation, that are you really solving a problem? Is there a need? For example, some of the post-harvest losses is something that's a pain point, or logistics is a pain point. If you look at the overall logistics cost, it's almost 23%. So if an MRP is 100, that means 23 rupees is being spent in the logistics of that product. Whereas if you look at it in the Western world, it's hardly 7%. So there's a 16% efficiency that can be driven there. So opportunities are everywhere. You just have to figure out what your expertise is, what is your USP, how you can drive value, how you can add value. And if you want me to give specifics, then I can give specifics one-to-one also if they want. But the idea being cold, it's cold storage, there is post-harvest losses reduction. Dairy is a very big industry, especially value-added products. It's immense. Delivery is an immense the scope for delivery.
Okay. Subha, would you like to answer? Yes,
I think rather than add, I'm only going to paraphrase a little bit what Nilesh is saying, is that today it will be very attractive to go into a range of new products which are Ayurveda based or immune boosters or all of that, because that's we're hearing a lot of buzz around it. But I would also, which is what I also heard from Nilesh, is caution against that, because for somebody who's just starting off, we are trying to go and create an entire new market segment. It is possible, but it is easier to stick to the basics. It's easier to stick to the essentials, which are a gap which have always been there. So start with something very basic, something very fundamental, which has a larger market, rather than go in and create a new market. It's possible. Nothing to stop them, but my opinion. But yes, always a good time for food. People will never stop eating, so why not?
That's interesting. So basically, the same set of challenges and opportunities exist, but one has to be more attuned to the changed circumstances. Be a little more proceed with a little more caution than usual.
Yes, absolutely. And then, for all we know, with the session we missed of the Honorable Finance Minister, there might be a whole lot of attractions which help the food industry or the small industry startup. So it might actually be a better time to start now.
Well, in the interest of time, I'll proceed to one more question, which is interesting to me. But yes, if anyone has any more questions, please put them in the chat box and I'll try to sift through them. So the other question is from another student, Ms. Neha George. She's basically asking if, what should be the strategy in terms of for startups? Should we be targeting on food processing companies? Should we start looking inward, target domestic markets or go uber local? Would that be more beneficial broadly for newer entrants instead of looking at the export markets? Again, a question for both.
In my opinion, always more economical to cut your teeth in a local market, get your systems in place. But having said that, it depends very, very strongly on your type of product and where the market for that product exists. If it is something which is meeting a large gap in a country elsewhere, why not? You could as well start off with that. Most countries have very clear regulations and very clear requirements of certifications. These are all available on their websites. We have a mutual recognition agreements of APIDA of EIC with very many countries. So the ease of doing business in terms of understanding the requirements of the customer country exists. Yes, largely dependent on the kind of product.
Nilesh, would you like to add something? Are you there, Nilesh?
You're muted, Nilesh.
I think you're muted.
Yes. Yeah. So, Subha mentioned about APIDA. So, if you're a member of APIDA or on the APIDA website, you can also get a list of things that India is exporting. So, for example, I mentioned gherkins. Gherkins is something that in probably half the population who's attending today are not even aware what that product is. But India captures more than 16% of the market share, the global trade that is happening of gherkins. So, we need to understand what products are being sold, in what form, in what area, you know, whether it's abroad or in India. So, there's huge scope. You need to understand the demand, like even those corn on the cob. That's a big thing that if you travel to Europe, you will see those two cobs being packed in a, you know, vacuum kind of package and being sold in retail stores over there. So there's a demand. Whereas in India, hardly anybody is buying those kind of those cobs, you know, corn on the cobs kind of product here. So, but I do agree, it's easier to penetrate into India, make all the mistakes that you want to make while you're still penetrating markets in India. Once you're very stable in terms of your systems, quality, processes, then probably going abroad is a better idea. Though I would like to add that countries like Japan are very, very good paymasters. So if your product can get Japanese approval and it's a big hit there, then sky's the limit. You don't have to sell anything in any other country, to be honest.
Thank you. Well, I have a few more questions, but I still see a lot of everyone is here, so I think everyone is interested in this. So, just one or two more questions, if you'll allow. If you guys are running late, Nilesh and Subha.
Yeah, we can take two questions, maybe.
So, basically, what the participants here want to know is whether there's a single vendor clearance system. I'm sure that will be different for, you know, whether you want to export, you want to sell domestically. But is there something approaching a single vendor clearance system for the license for a food processing entity that wants to start up right now?
I'm on a call.
For licensing or for certifications?
Yes, for certification and licensing.
Unfortunately, I'm not sure that we could call it a single window, though a whole lot of there is a lot of ease of doing business because of the online applications now. There has been a reduction, but it is definitely not a single window. You need to still get your other manufacturing licenses, be that a factory license, be that NOC from the Maya department, be that your taxation, your PAN, your GST, all of that. In addition to your FSSAI license, yes, FSSAI license methodology of seeking has been simplified to some extent. There are very many consultants who are quite proficient and competent, and maybe they could be somebody who does this, does the entire work of easing the applications for licenses. But from a government authority, as of now, a true single window, it's not yet. In terms of certifications, most certification bodies offer a range of the certifications that we discussed. And once you decide what you want to do, you could shop with some of them, check what all certifications that are on your list are available with those certification bodies. But by far, for process certifications, almost all will be offered by certification bodies. Many also offer some of the product certifications that we discussed. Or at least,
I believe a lot of the processes are also online now to make it more, it's easier to apply, right?
For the regulatory licensing, yes. For certifications, not online, the audit still happens on site. Now, under the COVID situation, there have been certain certain measures taken to start online audit for processes and at least continue certifications that are already in place. But we need to see how that pans out as we go ahead.
So state of Maharashtra.
The last question. Yeah, please.
State of Maharashtra has launched a Maitri portal, which is basically the single window clearance. But like Shubha mentioned, it has not reached a level yet where you know, it can really be a single point of approval. So, but I think we are on the right track. We will probably get there in the next few years where it will really become single window. So people can Google and find out. It's called Maitri, M-A-I-T-R-I, Maitri.
So we have a last question, which is what would be a better strategy than the traditional FMCG model for emerging health and wellness food brand? This is from Mr. Santosh Kemundu. And I think a lot of us will you know, sort of resonate with this, because for a startup, it's often very difficult to subscribe to that same model, you know, especially if you come from a product that's new and up.
Sorry, can you just repeat his question, Sanju? I didn't get that completely.
Sorry. The question is, what would be the an alternative strategy other than the FMCG distribution model for an emerging health and wellness food brand?
I am a strong believer in social media marketing. As long as you have the ability to do a direct delivery to your consumers, I think that cuts costs and keeps your operations lean. So I believe that is something that can be considered as an alternative strategy. But really, Nilesh's area of expertise.
Yeah, it also depends on the product. I mean, MLM. I'm not a big fan of MLM, but it has proved, like Amway has proved, that MLM model also works, especially for health products, where you know there's some little bit of product explanation needs to happen. So I feel that the distributor retailer model is here to stay, because logistics cost is very high. There are very few people who can actually do the last mile delivery very efficiently. So if you can get into that space, I know now even Jio is looking at that, because if you can have a retailer who's really doing a last mile delivery, and that's where the value can be added, the cost can come down.
Right, makes sense. I think we'll have to, there are a lot of more questions, but we have to stop in the interest of time. I hope both of you will be fine with participants getting in touch with you, the emails that you'll share if they have more specific questions. So I just want to thank Nilesh and Shubha Prada. Thank you so much for making time for this, and all the participants as well, because as all of you know, the finance minister must have been done with the speech by now. So we will get to that after this. Thank you so much, and have a good day.
Thanks a lot. Bye.